is Totally 80s, the podcast dedicated to the music of the greatest decade ever. So, turn up your Walkman, loosen that scrunchie, and get ready to talk 80s with your host, Lyndsey Parker.
Hi, I'm Lyndsey Parker from Yahoo Entertainment and SiriusXM Volume, and welcome to another Safe at Home episode of Totally 80s. And since we're all at home, why not take a second to follow us at Totally 80s on Facebook and Instagram, and email us your comments and show ideas at podcast@totally80s.com. Just a reminder, if you want to see our faces, you can check out this episode on video as well on our Totally 80s YouTube channel. So check that out. And joining me today, as always, is my partner in all things 80s, the other John Hughes, as he will always be known to me, the other John Hughes.
I'll take it. I mean, I can't usurp the king John Hughes, so I'll be the other John Hughes. Just fine.
You're in good company, though. You're in good company. So Today we're welcoming back someone to the show. The last time we were on, we were talking about music on TV. Not music TV, not MTV, but other ways we got our music fix on television in the 80s. And we were having such a great time. We spent so much time talking about Solid Gold and American Bandstand and Friday Night Videos and MV3 and Soul Train, and the list goes on, that we ran out of time. So we asked her if she would come back, and she so graciously said yes, because we just couldn't. We couldn't leave it there. There was just too much to talk about. We're going to get into a really exciting part deux in a moment. Our special guest today, returning guest. This is, I believe, our first returning guest. This is our first encore presentation. She's a producer, director, writer, visual artist, and pop culture documentarian. She's directed many music videos for artists like Julianna Hatfield and Creamer. She's the creator of the instant cult classic Network 77, which is a retro-futuristic collection of comedy and music. And under that umbrella, she has developed music programming like The Hayden Triplets Show, Star Pop, and most recently, Musique. She's also an experienced podcast guest. Yes, because she's been on Totally 80s before. I wasn't reading that off a script at all. But yeah, that script is true. She is an experienced podcast guest. She's a friend of Totally 80s, and we're very happy to welcome back Rachel Lichtman.
Hello. Hello. Thank you.
Happy to have you back, because I'm, you know, we just need to keep going where we're going. When we last were talking, we were talking about how MTV kind of was where people were getting their weird music video fix in the early days, when MTV was playing pretty much any weird new wave artist that was coming out of England. And then MTV became huge. And then there were other shows that came out that were sort of kind of filling the void that MTV had vacated. Now that MTV was playing superstars, we need another place to get that underground stuff. And when we left, I believe we were talking about Night Flight.
For people who take their rock and roll seriously, Night Flight delivers. Everyone who's anyone is talking about it.
Hi, I'm Grace Jones.
Hi, this is Adam Ant.
Hi, this is Steve Miller. When I fly like an eagle, I fly a night flight.
Yeah, that was a real game changer for me, personally. I mean, it wasn't just about, you know, sometimes MTV would have, like in the early days, there'd be videos that were like a little scary, like, you know, oh, it's like a... It's a roasted chicken with cobwebs on it, or like high heels walking by hot steam, you know, and you're like, ooh, like, what is all this? And then Night Flight sort of picked up where that like left off, you know, where you're discovering an entire universe of weird B movies, old and new, and A movies. Like, I first saw Magical Mystery Tour on Night Flight, and with commercials and the whole thing. And in those days, because we were early cable adopters. So, you know, anything on the USA Network. By the way, Dance Party USA is another one. That was a thing.
What about Dance Party USA?
Nine Inch Nails on Dance Party USA.
Yeah. USA.
I'm trying to hear Dance Party US fucking A.
What like cable was like, we don't know what our audience is. Like, USA didn't have like an audience. They weren't like, oh, Silk Stockings, let's like put that show together. So Night Flight came on, and it was like this world of like Andy Warhol's Dracula, you know, and the Fabulous Stains, and like, you know, this other world that was like just completely foreign to me, that I discovered at a time where I was like I was open for business when it came to like, what can this like small town gal absorb from these worlds, you know? And I feel like Night Flight was the biggest influence I can think of, really, for me at that time.
I discovered Bauhaus from Night Flight. Yeah, they used to, for whatever reason, I don't care what the reason was, I just want to thank them for it. Whatever reason it was a good reason. But for whatever reason, they were showing like a Bauhaus concert video all the time. It was on like almost everywhere. And even though Bauhaus, you know, legendary, set the template for goth. Listen to our goth podcast, by the way, everybody here. That was a really good one. You know, Bauhaus, very important band, but MTV did not get on board with Bauhaus. I don't ever remember seeing a Bauhaus video on MTV. I don't remember seeing them on even K-Rock out here. They may have played Bela Lugosi, but probably a very severe radio edit of it. But Bauhaus, entire Bauhaus concert at like 1 a.m. on my TV, like, that blew my mind, and that completely, I will always associate Night Flight and Bauhaus in my mind together. That's my fondest memory.
Even 120 Minutes would play stuff like Sisters of Mercy or something like that. Bauhaus. It was really not, I don't think they ever played Bauhaus. And, but then remember that last time we were together, we spoke about the ratio of like comedy to music in some of these variety shows. And in Night Flight's case, it was a ratio of like, kind of like Liquid Sky-y, like Reefer Madness, like cult classics, like, you know, weird old black and white things that you didn't know about. And like, so it brought in this like art house cinema to then the music was the other part of that. And so that was a whole new combo platter of information that, you know,
As someone who works at Rhino Records, I really appreciated the curatorial aspect of Night Flight because there were themes. It was always take off to goth, and it was there would be like music videos, concerts, Bauhaus, or in a feature length that was like The Hunger or something with David Bowie.
I believe I saw The Hunger on Night Flight. I feel that was a thing.
Better for me as a teenager in the 80s than on Friday and Saturday nights hearing Pat Prescott come on and talk about how, you know, tonight, Night Flight, take off to New Wave. And I would get so excited.
Night Flight brings you Shriek Back, Susie and the Banshees, Echo and the Bunnymen, and more new sounds after this.
And the best part was you would stay up till 3, I think it was, and it looped. It would start over again at 3 a.m. because it was only a 3-hour show. And it was just the best. I loved it so much.
I loved it too. And even like weird stuff. I mean, it did loop. God, I think I saw The Terror of Tiny Town like 20 times in like a week because it was just constantly going. And it's funny when you think about how early cable started to develop too, other shows that as MTV developed, the curatorial aspect became a really important part of that. For example, when Comedy Central was the comedy channel, and also there was Ha. So there were those, and they also curated a bunch of, it was like stand-up versus like episodes of Supercar or like weird old stuff that they just started to pack with content. It's funny that we're almost back at that place now where there's so many different streams that everybody's trying to like pull stuff together into something that's packaged up content-wise. In those days, it was the Wild West. Nobody was even minding the store. You could really just get away with like, look, we've got to fill time.
Yeah. You
know, Mystery Science Theater 3000 is a great example of a show that was greenlit because they needed to fill the time. You would never pitch a 90-minute show with like basically unknowns with puppets and the whole thing and be able to run on a loop like they did as well. But the thing is, you take a chance on things like that and you end up with a cult audience who just like dines out on you for the next like 30 years. Here we are still talking about this stuff. You know,
honestly, I'm feeling like, you know, obviously we're living in a terrible time right now, but something good that could come out of this is people are so hungry for content now. There's time to fill. People are at home and they're not going out and they're going to eventually get through their Netflix queue. Like maybe this would be a time for whether it's an online thing or the TV networks to start experimenting with this format again and say, let's take a chance on some crazy ass shit because, you know, people want to watch stuff and there's going to be someone captive, literally captive audience at home.
Look, Network 77 is a show. I started this show literally for us. It is for us, okay? There are jokes in there, and it's for Gen X. It's structurally nostalgic, okay? Everything I've ever done is long form, or it's a contextual collection of music from people who deserve to be there. It's egalitarian, you know, and it's also curatorial for sure. And that to me is really important at a time when you've allowed the algorithm to take over. You know, there are still people out there, including the three of us, just together, all three of us individually in everything that we try and do. We are really good at that kind of thing. You know what I mean? We're good at it. And we're good at it because we came up with those types of influences. And, you know, we aspire to that. I want to create things that an 18-year-old kid who's like in art school right now sees and is like, oh my goodness, like, and it's like funny or entertaining to them. Or I introduce them to a band that they might not have known because it didn't pop up in their playlist. Okay. I won't mention any corporate names.
I do want to jump in and say Network 77 is really amazing. It's a piece of work. If you guys have not checked it out, you've got to see it. It's one of those things that will take you back to this era, and you'll get it immediately if you listen to the show.
I'm going to check that out. Well, speaking of curatorial, though, and also sort of tacking on to what we were talking about with the aesthetic of Night Flight, even though I just got done saying that MTV started to drift away from it, it was just because they got into, as Rachel has mentioned before, the programming became more specialized instead of being music for all. And of course, there was, you know, Yo MTV Raps, and there was 120 Minutes, which I was addicted to. There were all these specialty shows.
Right.
But one kind of like just weird show that was very curatorial was IRS's The Cutting Edge. I was obsessed with it. The fact that this show existed on MTV in the mid 80s, where it was like, you know, Peter Zaremba from the Fleshtones, he hosted it. And they had like, but I actually discovered there was some very weird stuff on it. I remember very specifically finding out about the Bat Cave and Specimen from IRS's The Cutting Edge, because they went over to London to do a whole feature on it. That blew my mind. That was like, that's the world I want to live in. But I actually was introduced, I know I was introduced to Terrence Trent D'Arby via this show, because he wasn't quite as big yet. And he was kind of just this like cool, you know, revivalist soul guy from England. I remember, I think this is really colored, and I've probably talked about this, John, on the Madonna podcast we did. I think the reason why I've always sort of seen Madonna as kind of this punk underground East Village girl. And I'm very aware that that was where she came from, even though she became the biggest woman on the planet, is because I discovered her from IRS's The Cutting Edge. They showed the Lucky Star video, which looks like it cost $5. She looked almost kind of goth. She had all this jewelry on. She was in black. She was in netting. She looked, you know, very self-styled and kind of like punky and arty and ragamuffin-y. And I watched that video on IRS's The Cutting Edge, and Peter Zaremba was telling me this chick from the East Village was doing cool shit at Danceteria. So, you know, kudos to IRS's The Cutting Edge. That show meant a lot to me.
It was interesting because it was obviously the house organ promotional vehicle for IRS records, right? But they would feature other artists from other labels like Madonna, you said. The thing that really struck with me was in 1984, I was the biggest Smiths fan you will ever find on this planet. And the IRS is The Cutting Edge. They had Morrissey on once. And I remember it vividly. He was in a bathroom with just like a single camera on a tripod, no one else there. And they gave him a bunch of cards with words written on them. And he had to hold up the word and just describe what he thought about that particular word or what it meant to him. And you never saw Morrissey or the Smiths being interviewed on TV. It was like such a moment for me. And the fact that this record company was willing to spend money, I don't know if MTV co-financed it or what, on other labels' acts was like, hey, that's the power of content marketing right there. They were first.
Well, let's take a total 180. We're talking about all these like hip, cool, underground, you know, edgy shows. But we haven't yet talked about the best show of all time. Not just the best show of the 80s. Not just the best music show of the 80s. The best show ever. Put in on the hits. Best show ever. Oh my God. We're putting on the hits. We listen to the radio and shake down every hit. Just mouth the words and move it to the tune that fits. Put putting on the hits. Ow, we pick your song and let it out. Put putting on the hits. You know, No, they got the lip syncing right. You know, the lip syncing did not work so much on all these performance shows like American Bandstand, where all the artists were trying to like lip sync on Solid Gold at the end and didn't quite know what to do with their hands or their mouth or the mic because the song was weirdly fading out. But Put It On The Hits got it right. And I'm sorry, before there was this friggin' lip sync battle, before that, 30 years earlier, Put It On The Hits. Oh my God, I wanted to be on Put It On The Hits. It's like the most bonkers. I don't know if I can even impress on people how bonkers it was. It made the Masked Singer look like Meet the Press. This was some weird stuff. Actually, you could just read my entire article about it for the 35th anniversary that ran on Yahoo. Yes, that's right. I wrote an entire article about putting on the hits. And but we can talk about it here because I think, Rachel, you have some fond memories of this show.
I am here for a putting on the hits article slash conversation slash like
DVD box.
Let's just do a whole thing. So here's the thing. First of all, Alan Fawcett, who? I don't know. Okay, so here we go. Alan Fawcett, another one of these, like, you know, in that Solid Gold that we talked about last time, where it's like you just grabbed some personality. So then Puttin' on the Hits had that. First of all, I saw a lot of weird, like, new wave stuff. In fact, one of my mentioned, well, Adam and the Ants was definitely a big one that they always did. And then Sparks, of course, the through line to all of these shows somehow. There was the greatest performance. I feel like John Hughes, you might have seen me like Instagram this before, but it's like a brother and sister, okay? They do Angst in My Pants. And it's so, yes, so good.
When a 29-year-old recruitment consultant decided to pay tribute to the great act Sparks, he had to recruit his sister. Here they are, Tony and Susan Bram.
Hope it doesn't show, it'll go away. It's just a passing phase, it'll go away.
You can't dress nautical, learn to tie knots. Take lots of Dramamine out on your yachts.
And it's like
in my article.
Following up about this brother and sister and like their story, they were from Australia and they came to LA to be on the show, and it was this great thing. But I have to say that Puttin' on the Hits really brought, you know, this element of you, that, you know, first of all, it was obviously a game show. It was like a contestant-based thing, competition-based, okay? And some of the people though got really, really creative. Like, I'll never forget, there's like the half Lionel Richie face, half Diana Ross face for Endless Love.
My, there's only you in my life, the only thing that's right.
I have my top 10 here. For those listening who, I imagine if people
have a top 10.
I'm going to count them down, American top 10, Casey Kasem style now. For those, but I should say, I assumed everybody knew what this was. But when this article came out, I found out that this show was quite regional, even though it was a successful show, not everyone got it. So just real quick, for people who haven't figured out what this is, it was a competition, like a talent show, where people lip synced to hits. They were putting on the hits. And sometimes they just did it straight up. And sometimes they did like a full on like impersonation thing, like doing a Michael Jackson song while dressed in a red leather jacket and moonwalking. But some people got very creative. So I will count down my top 10. I'm so excited to do this. I'm going to do my own Casey Kasem. Number 10 is Metronome doing Heavenly Action, a relatively obscure song by Erasure, full on goth out. They all look like Martin Gore. Number nine, Infant Rock. So a bunch of guys dressed as babies in diapers. So I'll just leave it at that. Doing Bang Your Head by Quiet Riot. Number eight, Cupid by Donnie Love Dart. Keeping with the infant theme, a guy dressed in a diaper as Cupid singing Cupid, pull back. Number seven, Little Punk doing Shout. And he's basically dressed like Cherry from Pee Wee's Playhouse. Number six, the guy, another baby thing, Gregory Geiger doing baby face with what looks like a conjoined twin baby, like fastened to his shoulder. It's super creepy. We'll give you nightmares forever. Number five, Fancy Ray doing I Spell on You in a full-on Screaming Jay Hawkins mode. Number four, Fast Food. I don't know if you remember this one. This guy who like just did some kind of like weird fast food drive-in where he's like arguing through.
Yes, I remember from Dr. Demento.
Yes, and he's just in a car door window, like yelling yeah. through the window. That's number three. Debbie Sikta doing dancing from the Tubes from Xanadu. Yeah. Also half and half, she's doing both sides, you know, the Tubes and the big band. So she's got a like line of demarcation makeup in her face and she's turning. Yeah. Number two was 3D, a guy named 3D doing 19 by Paul Hardcastle. And like pretty much doing like the Max Headroom robot thing.
It's yesterday, by the way. Oh my God.
And yeah. Number one is a guy named Houston. You mentioned him. Houston doing Endless Love, a duet with himself. And the Diana Ross and the Lionel Richie parts.
I told you.
Drag on one half of his body and he's a man on the other half. And he, you know, before there was Lip Sync Battle, but also before there was RuPaul's Drag Race, there
before was Pearl. Before but Pearl after, doing it.
But after the Gong Show, like I'm listening to this yeah. and I'm thinking, this is really Gong Show like.
You're right. You're right.
You know what I mean? Like there was a celebrity panel of judges that was like Tony Basil and whomever. And then you were voted, you know, they couldn't gong you, obviously, but it's that vibe, you know. But my favorite part of Puttin on the Hits, can I just tell you, by the way, that list, I agree with every, and I'm just glad that I already called the number one before you even started it.
It was iconic.
You were going to show up to Puttin on the Hits with your face drawn in half, like you just go home, okay? So, anyway, but my favorite thing about Puttin on the Hits is that they would vote you on originality and appearance and lip sync. And then there's this computer calculation sound that they would do when they were trying to add up your points. It's like you're literally adding 10 plus 8 plus 2. You don't need the computer. Like, actually, put her away. Okay.
I do have a list of some of the, from this handy article that I'm so glad I wrote before doing this. Some of the celebrity judges that they had over the years were Helen Reddy. She was a judge. Hear her roar. Ugh. Paul Williams.
Of course.
Stephanie Mills. Marilyn McCoo, because he got around. Linda Blair. Don Felder from the Eagles, apparently, did it. And now, apparently, I went on YouTube and watched all this, so who are we kidding? But also, interestingly, at the very beginning of his career, when Brad Pitt was a very rising actor, he was on Growing Pains at the time, and I don't, you know, in a recurring role. He actually was a celebrity judge for the open call auditions at a Dallas mall. And yes, this is on YouTube. They show him coming, I'm going, hey, it's like someone put up their audition on YouTube, but they do show the Alan Fawcett's there, of course. He was representing. He was the big star of this, but then he's like, oh, we got from Growing Pains in Dallas, Brad Pitt. And Brad Pitt gets up and like waves and goes, hey, nice, happy to be here, whatever. His career was clearly downhill after that. You know, there is an Oscar winning actor who actually did go on the show. Cuba Gooding Jr. was on the show. He was, he competed in 1985, doing a Dougie Fresh tribute, but he, did not win. So the show did not show him the money. I'm sorry. I'll see myself out. He did not win, but he was on, it was called Cuba Gooding CG Productions. And they did a performance of the show by Dougie Fresh. And clearly that's what he should have won his Oscar for.
By the way, this is bringing up a very important point I want to talk about Showtime at the Apollo as well, which is another one. Speaking of like being exposed to a lot of stuff because Showtime at the Apollo, not to go away from Puttin on the Hits, because I'm certainly not.
No, but I like going down this talent show thing because this will lead into, you mentioned the Gong Show, which I think you're right, laid the groundwork. So the $1.98 beauty pageant or whatever it was called in the 70s. But then we had Puttin on the Hits. We're going to talk about Paul. We had Star Search. That was, I think the whole numerical addition thing that you were talking about came from the 4 stars, 5 stars thing. But let's talk about the Apollo, because there were some people that went on it that actually, like Star Search, you know, went on to be actual stars.
It was a big deal. I mean, I think that also the historical aspect of it too was so cool. And it was after Saturday Night Live in my market. I don't know about you guys. Mm-hmm. I just, you know, so I it was perfectly poised. So like I'm staying up, I'm watching it, you know. And again, just like being exposed to like this, it's like it is a competition, but the amount of talent and like the level of talent on that show was like through the roof, I would say, way more even than a Star Search. Like even just to rub that stump, like you had to be good. But my favorite part of it was always the ringer who would get Sandmanned off, you know, like, where you knew it was going to be like, oh God, here comes some rodeo clown. Like it's a total ringer. Here comes the Sandman, the best part, you know? So it was like, I mean, I just feel like that was such a great, and I finally went to the Apollo Theater actually just last year. I had never been to it. All the years, like I lived in New York, I never even went up there. So that was cool. It's that was a really interesting show.
The best part is watching the audience members that where they're super enthusiastic, standing up and cheering and like, or they're just like, boo, get off.
Yeah, throwing tomatoes and stuff. It was very much like the Gong Show or America's Got Talent. But I was going to say, of people who got booed off, this might not have been 80s, this might have been 90s, but I believe Lauryn Hill went on and was booed off.
I treat you bad.
Audience was half the entertainment for sure. It was that thing of like, I'm gonna, you know, the waving the art, like pointing out the door, like waving. Yeah, John, I'm so mad that we've never been in the audience.
I know. I would be like, can we sit in the front, please?
I know. Oh my God, I would give anything. That is
we haven't mentioned the awesome Denny Terrio in Dance Fever, by the way.
Oh my God,
which well, a lot of people think that's a 70s show, but it ran to like 1987 or something.
Exactly. And the longer it ran, the more bizarre it got. If you watch some of the latter, if you're a connoisseur of Dance Fever, you have to watch the latter day episodes.
Well, I'm definitely a connoisseur because it starred Adrian Zemed, the star. He after Denny Terrio left, Adrian Zemed was the host, and we all know him as the star of the fabulous movie Grease 2, which I've talked about before. But before, just real quick, I was looking it up. Yes, in 1987, at age 13, I'm looking it up on my phone right now. Lauryn Hill sang at the Apollo on Showtime at the Apollo and was booed off stage. Now she gets booed for not showing up on stage, but back then, but that was so obviously she was fine. But yes, let's go back to Dance Fever. It was, you know, it all started off in like, you know, it was a disco thing, you know, disco was huge and everything went disco in the late 70s. But I think a lot of people would be surprised to know that that talk contest, which you could say was maybe a forerunner of shows like So You Think You Can Dance, it lasted almost throughout the entire 80s and it, you know, got into it. It was more like what people like break dancing and like doing Michael Jackson type dancing and stuff like that.
First of all, I'm fascinated also by anything that was like Last Days of Disco that extended out like way past its sell-by date. I think that's a really fascinating era of like, it's like you're the last guy out of Vietnam or something. It's like, you know, everyone's moved on except for you. But Dance Fever had its own, basically made its own gravy. I mean, it was always great to just tune in and watch people dance. By the way, I also had a thing about, I don't know why these guys like Denny Terrio and Adrian Zemed, these like kind of like caramel complected dance guys, you know? And I loved him as Johnny Nogarelli, by the way, in Grease 2, which I was
excited
in Grease 2. So don't even get
The superior Grease. There's a recurring theme here. I just really wanted to be on a show. I really wanted to dance on either MV3 or American Bandstand or Dance Party USA or any of those dance shows. I really wanted to be on Puttin' on the Hits. I actually used to, I was going to do a Susie song. I probably spellbound, but I used to, you know, No, I actually wanted to do Like an Animal by The Glove, so I probably would not have ended up on the show. But I used to like practice in front of my mirror for that. And there were like I think Puttin' on the Hits actually, just to go back to that for a second, started lip sync contests all over the country in clubs and stuff because there was a club in LA that used to do it. And I
came in second place at Spanky's in North Ridgeville doing Thomas Dolby.
That's a video of that. And were your jeans cuffed?
No, I wore a lab coat, circle glasses. It was killer.
And I really wanted to go on Dance Fever too, because I think they had children's like, or teen episodes or whatever, like junior championships. Right. I really wanted to go on all these. And then there was another show that we haven't gone to. Before there was American Idol, there was Star Search. So Star Search, actually the heyday, when we're talking about people who got booed off stage or, you know, didn't went on these shows and didn't do so well, but then went on to do other things like Cuba Gooding Jr., who did not win on Put On the Hits. Actually, the heyday of Star Search was not the 80s so much. I do want to just say that when people auditioned for it in the 90s, when it was rebooted in the 90s, there are more people that came out of the 90s Star Search that did not win but had huge hits and huge careers than The Voice, American Idol, X Factor, America's Got Talent combined. Here are just some of the people who went on Star Search, most of whom have their performances available on YouTube on video. Tiffany, Justin Timberlake, Destiny's Child, who lost to a band called Skeleton Crew, Britney Spears and Christina Aguilera, pretty much anyone who was part of the Mickey Mouse Club, Alanis Morissette, Aaliyah, she was on in the 80s actually, Leon Rimes, the huge songwriter Shane McAnally, Usher, Bobby Brown, the spokesmodel who later was, and she won a bunch of times actually, who, you know, as we all know, was in Cherry Pie by Warrant and date a sex video with Bret Michaels and all sorts of other things. All of these people were on Star Search and most of them did not win. David Archuleta, who got big on American Idol, was on it. And so were a bunch of other people who later went on to Idol. But this was a pretty great breeding ground for talent. But in the 80s, I think the big success stories were Sawyer Brown, who actually were a legitimate country band that I think are still together. And they went pretty far. I don't know if they won, but they went really far. But do we all remember Sam Harris? Do we remember?
Sugar Don't Bite.
Sugar Don't Bite was his like semi-hit after he got done. He was supposed to be Kelly Clarkson. He was supposed to be huge.
I'm going to do my thing here. Got to number 36 on the Billboard Hot 100.
Respectable.
You're crazy, John Hughes. You know.
I know. Why do I remember this crap?
He had that thing where he like, when he got really emotional when he sang, like I think Somewhere Over the Rainbow was like his big signature moment. He was like
off his debut record, by the way. It did not chart.
Which that was?
And yes.
It didn't chart. Interesting.
Nope. Top 40 wasn't having Somewhere Over the Rainbow sung by an obviously gay man in 1986.
But he got over so well on the show. He would do this thing where he got really worked up and really emotional, and kind of his version of the Celine Dion like beating the chest thing was to grab the ends of his like tails of his long like ringmaster tuxedo coat and like kind of turn it into like a cape and like lift it above his head. Do you remember that? Because he was just so overcome with emotion. I thought he was going to be huge. Why wasn't, you would know this.
I remember the gold records, the like lapels of gold records on his shoulder that kind of like spilled down his long tuxedo coat. And, you know, there's Camp, there's Liberace, then there's Sam Harris. You know, you're only going to get so far with mainstream America in the 80s. With
well, that. I want to bring up something that you're talking about Star Search, and I actually have a point to make about Star Search, which is, first of all, I want to say that Star Search is where I really bailed. I watched some Star Searches, but it wasn't for me. It was definitely more of that, like, first of all, it's hosted by Ed McMahon. It's clearly a game show. The interface of it was not, had no artistry. It was pop, mainstream pop style, okay? And you're bringing up something else that's very interesting, which is the idea that when you look at any of these shows and what made them interesting and diverse and appeal to a larger audience, okay, is that you're talking about artists, like so many of them were from the LGBTQ community and were parts of like weird, like just sections of like of underground or whatever that were great and amazing and shaped pop music forever. And shows like Star Search completely like took that out of the equation. You're moving forward with this like Disney, like vanilla kind of, it basically set the tone for what the music industry would literally be going into the 90s and the aughts, of like these, like, you know, young pretty girls who can sing, okay? Which we have been held hostage by that now for the better part of 30 years. And it becomes a thing where you're literally taking out anything that could be interesting or different or unique about an artist, or even giving those types of artists a chance or giving them a platform. There is no platform for somebody out there who is super talented and, you know, might have been featured on, you know, early MTV, or might have been featured on one of these other, you know, it's just, it kind of the aesthetic.
Maybe that is true of Star Search. And they actually, as I mentioned, had a whole spokesmodel category that Bobby Brown, who, you know, from Cherry Pie, you know, and all these other big 80s hair metal videos, you know, she won multiple times. But I don't know if I 100% agree with you. I think I do agree with you when it comes to Star Search. But I do actually think when you look at the shows that Star Search very obviously begat, like mainly American Idol and then The Voice and X Factor. And I would say America's Got Talent too, even though it's not a straight up, you know, America's Got Talent actually might be the best example, because Star Search was not only music and neither is America's Got Talent. But I will actually say that I think those shows root for the underdog, because I'm trying to say this in a way that doesn't sound shady. The super pretty sexy girls never win on American Idol. The people who win are the girls next door. It is Kelly Clarkson. It is Jordan Sparks. It is Fantasia. Even Carrie Underwood, when she started, you know, didn't look nearly as glamorous on Idol as she did now, because people see them either. There's various theories. You could say that's women who are the people who mainly vote for these shows feel threatened by them, or you could say that they just don't seem like people that need the help, and you want to root for the person who wouldn't get a record deal otherwise because they don't look like a young, pretty girl that sings. Not that any of those girls aren't attractive. They were just attractive in like a very approachable girl next doorway. The sex pots on the show, like that's why when I'm talking about all these people on Star Search who didn't win, like Beyonce and Britney and Christina Aguilera, although they were kids when they were on, but you know, these kind of people who went on to be huge pop stars, maybe that's why they didn't win, is because I think these shows, the one thing I'll say, I totally agree with what you're trying to say or what you said, but I will say the appeal of these shows, at least on paper, starting with Star Search, was that they were supposed to give an opportunity to someone who wouldn't get it in the traditional way. When do we see like a certain year or a certain trend? What can we pinpoint to when like music on 80s television started to become, you know, for lack of a better way to describe it, less cool?
87.
Sure. 87. Okay. Why that year?
I don't know. Because it's like, I don't know why, but it felt like we were hurtling toward, it's like, I don't know why, but all the interesting, cool stuff from the beginning of the decade seemed to sort of had fallen, shifted into some, like, there's a lot of money being thrown at stuff. Like, there was a lot of, you know, egos being thrown around. You know, certainly MTV had changed its kind of programming and who they were marketing to, and also being a part of wagging this dog, like, deciding what was going to be the thing, and then the industry would follow, which is something that was completely the opposite when at the beginning of the decade, right? And so the star making machine of MTV, they made a lot of different choices. They started to develop different types of things, and for some reason I just feel like around that time the kinds of records that were being made, the way that the music business followed that, okay, knowing that a visual element was in play right out the gate. Like, that's when we're starting to, like, we're branding these artists with a visual element, you know, very clearly and distinctly, which is something that record companies were not thinking about. Again, this all started with radio airplay. This all started in a countdown economy of, like, who's on the charts. And now it becomes an image-based situation. And so when you switch to an image model, okay, then you're sacrificing chances on artists and records and weird things that might not fit your idea of what that imagery, you know, that image is. Really, it was the beginning of the whole industry, I think, changing into the 90s. And then the final, you know, when leading to like when grunge came along and then like reinvigorated the whole industry in a certain way. But definitely the visual aspect became, if I'm being clear here, I think that the visual aspect, everyone figured it out and they dialed it in a little tighter. That's my point, is that they dialed it in tighter and there wasn't enough room or oxygen for artists that were on the cutting edge or even near the cutting edge to break through.
That's well, I'm going to play devil's advocate for a second, because an argument that has been made, that was made back when MTV started, an argument that, for the record, I very much disagreed with, but a lot of the crusty, rockist, boomer, okay boomers of the time were against MTV and against music videos, because they were like, oh, it's too much about visuals. It's more about image than artists. And we can all think of artists that sort of didn't survive the transition on MTV because of how they looked or because they weren't making good videos. And there were a lot of people that thought back then in 1981, 1982, 1983, that the emphasis that the MTV, the rise of MTV had put on looks and image and presentation was eclipsing music. I didn't agree with that, but a lot of people do. I always thought music and presentation and fashion and all that go hand in hand. So we spent two podcast episodes talking about all these TV shows and how, for a lot of people, that was how we learned about music, whether it was Solid Gold or whatever. Do you think in the long run, we're like, they did more harm than good because it was more about watching the slinky Solid Gold dancers or whatever than it was about just the music itself? I don't feel that way, but you're sort of making an argument that the visuals became more important and
no, the image became more important. Okay. Image of something, and that even includes the backlash, for example, like when starting like in 86, 87, when I was really listening to like REM a lot, okay? And so I remember seeing REM for the first time on a show called Livewire. It was like some kids show on Nickelodeon hosted by that guy, Fred, what's his name, but he has white hair. And I think he's still around. Anyway, I saw REM on that show, and I remember thinking like, again, like as the pendulum swings back and forth, as I had gone from like my new wave fascination, and then all of a sudden here's this other band that looks nothing like these people with like heavy makeup and stuff on MTV now. These guys are like guys from a town like mine, you know what I mean? And so then that started to have an underground value, you know, and they did a lot of videos, but they were more about, I don't know, there was something about their credibility that was a selling point. And the pendulum swings from splash and trash and glam to this like credibility place that's been going on since the beginning of time, you know? So I feel like, you know, I don't know. I mean, there's a lot to parse, and I certainly don't have any numbers in front of me. John Hughes, I'll let you.
Yeah, John will have the numbers in front of him. So John, put on your nerd hat and tell me in your mind, where you think the maybe shark jumping point was for when music television, not MTV necessarily, but just music television, started to lose its cool.
I think Rachel's right on target. I think in 87, 88, you've got the cancellation of Solid Gold. American Bandstand disappeared into the ether in late 1986. You've got the end of our beloved Puttin on the Hits and Dance.
That was it. That was it. Yeah, when on the Hits went off the air, that's when everything went to shit. That's it.
And USA pulls Night Flight and, you know, right, reduces it, I think, only to like 2 hours, and then it gets syndicated. That's really kind of the end. I will be incredibly personal and selfish and say that's also after I graduated high school. I didn't have free time to watch TV anymore. So that's where it kind of faded for me personally. But I think there's a demarcation line there in 87, 88.
Well, I want to ask you this in terms of demarcation line, Sean, because you being like the nerdy and statsy guy, you'll know this. Did something happen around that time, 87, 88, in terms of like how people consume TV, like in terms of cable becoming or VCRs becoming a more of a widespread thing? Is there anything like that we can do where we can say, okay, the people were no longer sitting around for 3 hours waiting for that Night Flight to loop or whatever?
Yeah, you had not only MTV, you now had VH1, Turner Classic Videos, or whatever it was called, the Turner Music Channel that lasted like a half a year. Yeah. You had, instead of, you know, Night Flight, you had Night Flight and Radio 1990. Anybody remember that with Lisa Robinson? Yeah. You know?
Radio 1990, rock and roll with personality. Host Catherine Kinley with the latest and greatest from the world of music.
feature interviews and exclusive stories with journalist Lisa Robinson, and a bevy of rock's best. Videos, news, current events, all the facts and fun of popular music each weekday on the USA Network. Radio 1990, always a step ahead. At 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 Pacific, Monday through Friday.
You know, you had all these little spin-off shows. It was like, you know, okay, here, we're going to get super nerdy here. Since you asked me to be nerdy, I'm going to be nerdy.
Bring it on. Talk nerdy to me.
You used to have one X-Men comic book. All of a sudden, you had X-Men, Wolverine, the New Mutants. when something's hugely successful, you spin it off and you chop it up. It is so finely to a point where it's like the thing that made the one thing unique and popular is no longer unique. And so it kind of fades.
Well, one thing I want to wrap with is, and I touched upon this earlier, but we're now in a, you know, obviously viewing habits have changed a ton since 1987, you know, let alone the early 80s. And everyone, no one's really watching TV anymore. Most people watch things on streaming services, but we are. And, you know, it's like that book, The Long Tail, whatever, you know, everything's very fragmented. But the plus side of that is if there's something you like, you can probably find it online. You can, you know, whether you want to watch anything we were just talking about, you can find clips of it on YouTube. You can find all 18 of those Puttin' on the Hits clips on YouTube. Go watch them now after this podcast, everybody. But do you think that now with the internet or whatever, with streaming services, and with the fact that at the moment we're in the middle of a pandemic where people are staying home and consuming more content, do you think like this sort of, do you think there's an opening for music programming that has that early spirit of all of these shows we've been talking about, that Wild West spirit? Are we in the middle of another Wild West?
Can I just break in here for a minute and say, I really hope so, because I have been developing this for some time. And I, whether it is Music Laden or Top Pop or Top of the Pops or the Old Gray Whistle Test or whatever, my last program, Musique, for example, and by the way, I don't have a budget for anything I do. I basically go out and I do with my Rolodex and my camera and my skills and my graphics, okay? And luckily that lends itself to a certain level of like, you know, like groovy, low fidelity, you know, UHF, whatever. But I really believe, and Musique reflects this, that there needs to be another, like there should be a program that has interviews, that has live performances, that has promo films, that has even a look back, like little documentary moments and stuff. And this is something that I have been trying to do for some time. And I'm still, my phone is quiet right now, so we'll see. But I really hope it does. I think that the pendulum is ready to swing back again. We are ready to go back from that narrow casting of the internet where everybody's kind of in their own lane. Everybody's screaming over each other, trying to promote something, okay? To a place where context is important. Context matters when you're presenting a new artist. We're talking about a lot of stuff right now during this pandemic that we're all taking a second look at how sustainable it actually is. And I think that when it comes to how artists are functioning and making money and making records, you know, we all know that that's a struggle. We all know that it's a struggle to promote and to make on the back end. And now there is going to be, we're going to have some trouble with venues for a while. There will not be venues for a while. And
we need our live music in other ways. And this, you know, TV shows could be the way.
That's right. So
not just live streams from your living room, not just person on Instagram Live, creative stuff.
Produced content that is connected by some under the groovy umbrella that that puts everything together in a way that even that has a certain amount of artistry to it, or should, okay? Like the interface of it. And for anybody in my world or who's ever given me the advice of things being too long or having to make things clips on YouTube or do things like cutting it up and chopping it up, I've always fought against that. I want things to be long form again, even if it's just something you turn on for an hour and it's in the background, because that's what I want to see. And it gives artists a chance to breathe, and it gives you the resources to be able to promote an artist who deserves to be promoted, but maybe doesn't have the money that another, you know, we're really at a point where really, unless you have money, you can't get through. You just can't.
Well, I think the curatorial aspect you're talking about is important. There's a lot of noise out there. It's very hard to find stuff. So I very much encourage you to keep pursuing that. Also, please, You got connections. Can we revive Puttin on the Hits? I think the big takeaway from this entire podcast is that Puttin on the Hits needs to come back. If you were, if you tuned out a few minutes ago and you want just like the bullet points, that's it. Puttin on the Hits needs to come back. Like, can we not lip sync battle? That's fun too, but that's not the same thing. That's celebrities. I want like regular people just like randomly lip syncing to Billie Eilish songs while wearing like a wig with like green roots. Like, that's what I want.
Yes.
So,
and only if John Hughes will host it.
Oh my God. Well, we're going to have to co-host it, John, because I just came up, you know, we'll have to take this conversation offline, get our PowerPoint together, get our deck together. We are pitching this. It's going to happen. But there's so much stuff from the 80s, you know, in terms of its spirit, as well as its like lo-fi, scrappy aesthetic that really could apply to today's pop culture. So I hope that stuff happens. I've really enjoyed talking about all of these shows with you guys. Is there anything else, Rachel, that you want to talk about that you're working on that will keep this crusade going?
Well, I'm always working on all kinds of things all the time. And all of that stuff is over at network77.com. Network 77 is an independent channel, and it's basically, there's not even a Patreon for it. It's like, you know, viewers like you can donate to it so that I can keep doing this groovy stuff that I do. And I am working on another program right now, and it's really beautiful, and it's with a bunch of stuff I've had in the can for a while. So it's going to be great. I'm really excited about it. And of course, Musique, the most recent music show I produced, is up on the front page right now and features you know, Liam Hayes and Ted Leo and Julian Hatfield, and Amy Mann's a presenter, and commercials in it even for like Arden Studios, and commercials for like John Langford's art. And, you know, it's a beautiful like community vibe. And so I'm really proud of it. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. It's great. It's really great.
I'm going to sign off and watch all of that. And then I'm going to get on YouTube and watch all of the Puttin on the Hits videos and some Sam Harris on Star Search. I'm going to watch all of them. I'm going to take a big old deep dive. Thank you, internet, for existing. And thanks to our listeners. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, John Hughes, as always. I'm Lyndsey Parker, and I've been joined by John and Rachel, and we want to thank you guys for listening. Remember to rate us and review us on your favorite podcast platform, and we'll catch you next time.
This was Totally 80s, the podcast dedicated to the music of the greatest decade ever. Don't forget to follow us on Facebook and Instagram at Totally 80s, and please leave us a review on your favorite podcast platform. Until our next episode, catch you on the flip side.